So anyway, the basic idea is to chat. So
let's free chat. Wander.
This movie is now how long for you guys?
I think 9 years is
around
when,
nine.
Now that we're done?
Yeah, from like when the idea was first conceived of to
and was it conceived
now?
That at a one night when you were very, very baked? Or
I think like most ideas, there's not like a single moment where they come into being. It's kind of like a very slow, you know, we should do an R-rated animated movie. Oh, it'd be funny if it was about food. Like,
we separately had the idea to do something called Sausage Party.
Yes. Sausage Party was a joke title that we would use just like, in general, people would always ask us, what are you working on next? And we go, oh, it's called Sausage Party, just because we thought that sounded funny. But
one of Christine Vachon's
exactly.
favorite phrases
about
business.
Yeah, and it was Jonah one day was the person who said, what if Sausage Party was with actual sausages, and then we had all these ideas about animation, and that's like...
Yeah, and meanwhile, we'd been saying it'd be fun to do an R-rated animated movie, and then when those jokes kind of collided, and we were like, oh, we could make it about food in a grocery store.
Yeah. So is this everything for you? I mean, is this how you guys work on everything?
The movies that we write take generally, like, several years of gestation, I would say, right?
Like five.
At least three, like between 3 and 5 years of just like talking about them, and I think that's the time during which we're really kind of deciding whether or not it's a good idea, basically, and worth like pursuing. But like Superbad, we talked about for years. Pineapple Express took us years to kind of crack, and This Is the End was a short film, and then you know, kind of slowly evolved into a feature-length movie. And Sausage Party was kind of, yeah, like something that we would just kind of talk about a lot. And then after years of talking about it, we were like, let's sit down and actually try to write it, basically. But those years I would count like towards the writing process, you know? Like, yeah. I think it's an important part of it, that like casual talking, right?
Oh, casual chit-chat is...
It's very... You can't understate the value of casual chit-chat.
Most great ideas start off in a nice casual chit-chat.
So, yeah. So with Superbad, let's do a story about our childhoods? Or where did that...
Well, no, because we were that age. We were in high school.
It was like, still in high school when you started working.
Yeah, it was like, let's do a story about what we are experiencing right now because... Because there's no movies that we saw that were like representative of our high school experience. People didn't talk the way that we spoke to each other. It felt like social groups weren't depicted in the way that they were in our high school.
Yeah, and like when you're in high school, you have a unique perspective that like by the time you're 26 and writing the story about high school, you don't know what high school is anymore because
yeah.
Everything's changed.
Exactly. And so we started writing Superbad when we were like 13 or 14. And I mean, we made it. I mean, we were like in our early 20s. So we were like fresh right. out of high school, basically.
So what made you guys think that was a good idea to write a script at 13?
We just saw a bunch of crummy movies and thought, seems like...
We thought we could
crummy
do better
movies.
Than
crummy movies are getting made. We could, at worst, write one of these crummy movies
yeah.
and hypothetically have a career.
That really was it. It's like, from that age, we were like, it seems like we could do this. Like, we just saw what else was out there, and it felt like we could participate in it, honestly. And at the same time... We were big fans of like Kevin Smith and like Wes Anderson's movies were starting to come out around then. This is probably in like 1990, like 3 or 4, right? And so, and Pulp Fiction was coming. So like independent movies were having kind of this like awesome moment. And so that also was encouraging to us because we were like, we don't have to succeed in like this big giant way. Like if we write a good script, maybe we can make it ourselves. You know, maybe we can do what Kevin Smith did and get like $20,000 and just make it. Like it's a high school movie. It's set in hallways and houses, you know. That was...
And we also like, we were from Vancouver in Canada and we would see people filming around us all the time.
Yeah.
It's always been a film town. So it like kind of seemed possible.
They filmed movies at our high school. Like we went to a very like beautiful high school. Like it was very like they shot a lot of stuff there. And I think that was also a part of it is like you would just see it around. And so it didn't seem that abstract a notion to participate in it, you know?
So how did this end up leveraging with your acting career, your nascent then acting career?
It was a weird parallel. Basically, like, I did stand-up comedy throughout all of high school, and when I was, like, 16, I auditioned for Freaks and Geeks, like, from Vancouver, and then moved to L.A. Around then, in 1998.
And you never thought about performing?
I'm too sweaty. I'm too fidgety. Like, true. In this interview, you'll notice me fidgeting nonstop. I just can't sit still. You have to be, like,
that
calm.
Could be part of your persona as an actor.
But the continuity will be annoying for the editor. Yeah. I think of all the repercussions down the line.
So acting, so you came to L.A., and were you still hanging out in Vancouver, I guess?
I went to school in Montreal. Okay. I needed a degree to get a visa to get down here. It's a boring story.
He would come out in the summers, though, and we would write, we would work on Superbad, and we started writing Pineapple Express around then, in like 2000, probably, or 2001,
and we would just write,
maybe.
We bought like a headset phone pieces that you had to plug into your phone and would write.
Yeah, we would write over like when he was in Montreal in school and then I was in LA, we would write over the phone together a lot on Superbad. And
so do you still write the same way you guys wrote back then?
We separate and talk on the phone.
Yeah, exactly.
No,
we sit in a room. Well, then when we could, we would sit in a room together. We never like divide the work. Like sometimes just, and it was always like this, just by nature, one person isn't available and the other person will just continue basically. But we're never like, you do scenes 3 through 6 and I'll do scenes 1 through 3 and then we'll get together and look at them. Like we like to work as much as possible, like together in the same room at one computer. Like we each have a desk with one computer and 2 chairs at it.
But we got 2 screens now.
Yes. Well, I know when we're getting standing. Yeah, we pace a lot. We're trying to stand more. That's the big thing.
So scene by scene, or do you go through the whole thing and then start polishing?
We outline. We kind of make like we outline.
We outline
a lot.
Like a
outline
lot.
Is like what takes the
longest. End outline will be 40 pages, and we practically have said the dialogue that we'll be writing to each other a million times already. So to us, like the 40-page outline is almost the script.
Yeah, but that's like basically we start by making like lists of just ideas, and they'll have titles like possible settings, possible set, and like once we come up with the idea, you know, like it all starts with like an idea that you have talked about for years and you're like, yeah, that could actually be a movie. And then you start to make just huge lists of the characters, the specifics, wardrobe ideas, anything, and then slowly those lists like will start to become an outline and such, and then you'll make a document that's like rough series of events, and then that kind of begins to expand and fill in basically with all the details from your other lists. That's how we do it.
Do you ever get to a point where you like start and you think you have the idea and it's going to be a viable script, and then you start and you're like, "Whoop, we were wrong."
Oh, we just did that aggressively. So we just thought we had a great idea for our next movie, worked on it for like 2 months, and then realized it was fundamentally flawed and scrapped the whole thing.
Huh. Wait, which one?
The escape.
Oh yeah. No, it's true.
We had like a flushed out movie.
It's still not. I'm just not convinced we won't do it one day. But it was.
There's a fundamental flaw.
It seemed crazy. It just seemed crazy.
There's just one part of it where you're like, I don't buy it.
Yeah, you just. Yeah, it's true. But we didn't. But that's why. Like, but then this other. But then we have another idea that we're working on that we've been talking about for like around 2 years, probably in some rough form. Mm-hmm. And maybe 6 months ago, we finally sat down and started to like write it. And this one. I think
it feels like it can. We're not even. We can't say it will.
Yeah,
but we feel
but
like
it feels
it
like
might.
It will. But yeah, the other one. Yeah, we worked on it. It was probably like two. Yeah, it was probably like 2 months of work.
But it's before. The first. It's the first thing in a long time where we like worked on it. Like
yeah.
We really sat down and tried to get it going, and it just didn't.
Yeah, and it just didn't add up. Which it was
better than making it.
Yeah. Better than making it, exactly.
So how do you divide up your time in terms of doing all the things that are going on in your lives at this point?
We have a system with our office, and they send us a schedule, and we just live by it. And
yes.
We question nothing. Between like 9 and 7, we'll do anything they say as much as they need us to all day long. And we manage to get it all done.
Yeah.
So you just go to work every day.
Basically, yeah. Yeah, and in that, there'll be days where we're not doing any like producerial work, and those days we'll just write. And every day there'll be chunks of time when we can kind of work on our own stuff, but
we've had to carve out a little more time than we used to. We like wanted to get back to doing more writing than we have.
Well, we've been like building a production company kind of for the last several years, and now that it's kind of up and running and has like a great infrastructure and a lot of projects that are able to maintain that infrastructure, now kind of in the last, again, like 6 months basically, we've kind of been able to take a step back a little bit and refocus on writing and directing and the things that
we
like doing more than producing.
And do you like directing equally to writing, or is it just an extension of the same? Or
no, because we've been directing stuff that we aren't the primary writers. Like on Preacher, we help conceive of it and kind of like have a hand in it, but we're not like writing it, you know. And it's really fun. It's incredibly gratifying.
It's certainly like we're learning things about directing from that process, from us not being the writers. That is, like, it's crazy. Scripts just keep coming in so quickly.
Yeah.
And you have little time to adapt. Relative to movies, it's a lightning fast operation.
Yeah. But to direct, yeah, but it's great to work with a writer who's really great and who writes very differently than we do. And I think it forces us as directors to do things that we wouldn't do if we were just directing our own material, because he comes up with ideas that we would just never come up with.
You know? So do you really like directing?
Yeah, we love it.
What is it? I mean, when you started doing it, at least on a professional level, what was that change? I mean, how hard was it to make that step?
I mean, it was very hard, but it's super gratifying because you know that if it doesn't turn out the way you wanted, it's just your fault.
Yeah.
You're the director now, and you get to, you know, do what you hoped you could do on the page. As the writer, when you hand something off, it's weird.
There was a point when we didn't want to be directors. Like, if you asked us while we were filming, like, Pineapple Express, like, do you guys want to be directors? We would say no. Like, we want to be writers, and we'll hire great directors to direct our movies, and it's great. And then I think part of it was out of fear, honestly. Like, I think we just didn't think we could do it. Like, it seemed, I think at that point, we couldn't do it. And I think,
and it also has this mystique where make it seem unattainable. Like, no, you just have to understand several basic elements of film and have a vision and really work very hard.
Yeah, I think, and then as we just got more experience and produced movies that were more complex and had bigger scales and we had a bigger role in the producing of them, we reached a point where we were like, we will direct other people's scripts, but it's hard to imagine that we would write a script that we didn't also then direct, because in the writing now, we are, it's you know, we're kind of directing it. We're picturing how it's going to look, how it's going to be shot. And it's been very gratifying. Like with This Is the End, that was the first thing we ever directed, and there was something very, you know, I think that beginning to end process of like conceiving of something and really seeing it through into its final completion, every element of it, the music, the look, the lighting, the wardrobe, when it really reflected your vision and the audience appreciated it as much as you hoped they would, it was more gratifying than just any of the singular jobs, I think. Right.
Not intimidating, because I mean that movie is pretty sophisticated. I mean, there are a lot of things you guys did that could have gone terribly, terribly wrong.
Like it was a big swing.
Ground opening up, and
The special effects were kind of scary because we'd never executed something quite that sophisticated. But we surrounded ourselves with like all our super funny friends, and we worked on the script a long time, and we knew we were coming to it at the base level with like at least a good script. At least a good movie.
Well, it makes you realize as how much of directing is having a good cast. Like, that was really one of the reasons that movie, for us as directors, for our first movie, was manageable. Because we were able to focus on a lot of the technical stuff, because it is a very technically complex movie. There's like 1,000 visual effects shots in that movie. And so, if we were also having to worry about the cast not being funny enough or not having a good grasp of their characters, that would have probably been more than we would have been able to manage in some ways, you know?
And because we worked with them all so much, you know, if I was working with some guy I've never worked with before, he might not be like, hey, you should try this, like Franco would or Jay would or someone else would. They brought their experience and kind of like helped push us along. And also Brandon Trost was
the DP
incredibly,
was
incredibly good.
So what's it like to shoot your friends, to direct your friends? Is that easy in this case, or do they make it easy or not?
It's mostly a benefit, and then when it isn't, it's very frustrating.
Yeah, it's like working with your friends, like, in any regard. It's mostly great, and sometimes it sucks for all this reason.
Yeah, like 9 out of 10 times you're just having fun, and then when there is some kind of disagreement, you have to disagree with your friend instead of just some guy.
Yeah, exactly, and a whole level of emotions come into play that wouldn't come into play with just an actor that you didn't care about your long-lasting relationship with.
Well, it seems like a kind of a defining part of your guy's career that you that a lot of the same people are involved in a lot of the movies and a lot of the relationships. And
well, I think that's how we're able to get them to do stuff, though. Like, and that's one of the reasons we directed This at the End, and in Sausage Party, it's not that different, where it's like, they wouldn't have played themselves. Like, you, no other actors who wasn't, or directors who wasn't friends with them would have been able to convince Jonah and Franco, Danny and Jay and Craig to, and Emma and Aziz and all the people to play themselves in a movie where they portray themselves horribly and then die for the most part. Like, the only way we were able to do that was because of those personal relationships and because of the trust that's there because we've worked with them over and over and over again. And Sausage Party was no different. Like, everyone knew it was a big risk, and then if it went south, like, they were all a part of something that was potentially, like, very damaging to them, you know? Mm-hmm. And the fact that they were willing to participate in it, and not just participate, but really, like, go for it and make it, and elevate it, and add ideas to it, and make it funnier and funnier, was because of the pre-existing relationships, for the most part, and the trust that had been built up over years and years and years, you know.
I'm guessing that shooting, that doing the voices for Sausage Party was not like most animated movies where there's somebody in a box in Emeryville and they go up twice in over a year and that's about it.
I mean, it was and it wasn't. Like, it wasn't in that, even though I wasn't recorded, I was there for almost all the recording sessions. So I would generally be reading with the actors. And most of the actors are interacting with me throughout it anyway. And so that was something that was different from my experience in animation. It was actually just the actors generally got to read with an actor. And we always had Evan also and Kyle Hunter and Ariel Shafir, who are the two guys we wrote the screenplay with, in the room as well at all times. So we were constantly trying new things, and the actors were obviously always encouraged to try new things. And it's a different style of improv because it's not like you interacting with another person. It's like something will come up and then we'll have to write it down and be like, oh, in 3 weeks, Craig's coming in. We'll have him respond to that thing you just improvised, and maybe he'll say this. So maybe you should say this in case he improvises something along these lines. So it actually was outrageously complicated as like far as layering the improv that we were getting, but we really wanted to try to replicate in some ways kind of like the looseness of what I consider to be the best comedies, where it feels a little off the cuff, you know, which animation doesn't always have. It feels very regimented and rigid at times, you know? And so that was something that we talked about, yeah.
So do you have like a script supervisor who's very carefully noting all of these things?
No.
Or you guys just kind of...
Not on this
one. You probably should have.
In hindsight, that is
that
a really
a
good idea.
Yeah.
We could have saved a lot of money and time.
Well, you mentioned the script. I didn't even think that. Yeah, it seems so simple in retrospect. No, we did not. We just did it ourselves.
Where were you?
Yeah, where were you, man? Shit.
And did people come back in, or were you...
Yeah, we had...
Yeah, people came in like 2 to 4 times each. We didn't get them a ton because we were pretty low budget, but we got them enough, and they would come in if we really needed them.
Yeah.
And is there anybody who didn't want to say what they were told or what play roles that were quite as profane as some of them are?
No. Everyone was... We asked the right people.
Selma was kind of a particularly great moment in that...
Oh, she really...
She doesn't usually do filthy.
She
did it beautifully. For
she came in strong, and we did not, like, know her at all. I had dinner with her once, like, 8 years ago and mentioned it with Edward Norton and her because they're friends.
Right.
And he like badgered her, you gotta do this, you gotta do this if it ever happens. And he reached out to her and got her to do it.
Yeah, people
so
were...
We owe Edward for the time.
We've had enough experiences in the past with people kind of arriving and not being completely gung-ho that at this point we have all those conversations very explicitly where it's like... If you like, it's going to be really dirty. So, if you don't want to do that, then you probably shouldn't do
it. But no one got in the room and didn't give it the
No, if anything, they escalated the intensity.
And it's crazier to see like Salma and Edward say things than everyone else. It's just weird to see people who you aren't used to saying like filthy jokes.
Yeah.
Like, most great. Everyone else had been in something really dirty, but both of them.
Yeah, how was Edward part of your guys' life?
We've been friends with him forever.
Yeah, through mutual friends, we've known him for almost a decade. And yeah, we've just stayed very close throughout this whole time.
Waiting for just the right role for...
Yeah, it's one of those things where it never seemed... We talked about it, I mean, and he's a big comedy fan, like...
But we never offered him a role in anything. We weren't he'd like that.
I kind of, like, we would joke about how, like, we'd probably never have something that we would actually work together on, really. And then this was the thing that it happened with, which is kind of shocking, but... It's awesome that it was. I mean, he's probably one of the first people we like told the idea to. Like, just like, I can't remember the exact time, but like, he's known about the idea from like the very, very, very beginning of it, like almost 9 years, or if not 9 years.
No, we were like telling him, like, we came up with more. Yeah. Oh, now we think maybe it should be animated.
And I think he was probably the, like, maybe aside from me and Jonah, because we came up with the very original idea, he's probably the first actor that was like attached to be in the movie, like from its beginning.
Attached to Sausage Party.
He wanted to play the bagel.
Yeah, we let him choose his character.
Yeah.
He went right for the bagel.
Went right for the bagel.
What is the story with Jonah in this regard? I mean, he actually has another credit as a story by for Why Him, which is coming out shortly.
Really?
He does?
Yes, he does.
I didn't know that.
He does.
That's cool. Wow, that guy's just
good for him.
Shooting out stories.
We have this thing that people just are hanging out, funny people who do these movies, and everybody kind of, because he seems to be writing and also acting.
I mean, we developed with, I mean, he was just like one, like, in that, like, years of conversation part, he was just, like, a very key part. And the very beginning, the core of the idea was conceived of by me, Evan, and Jonah. And so, and then as we talked about it for years after that, he was instrumental part of the conversations, and then when it came time to actually sit down and write it, he was off acting in Academy Award nominated roles as we were sitting in my living room. And so that's why he has story credit, because he really came up with the story for the movie with us, and then we wrote the screenplay with Kyle and Ariel. Yeah.
So what was it like when you started to see actual animation come out of the process for this movie?
It was like so the amazing.
Most the most thrilling thing ever.
Yeah, it was really incredible. We really like... It escalated the comedy so much more than we ever could have hoped, which was so nice. And we had been testing the movie a lot in just hand-drawn format. So... to then get to test it with the animation was like, and we were hard on it in its hand-drawn format, and we would keep changing it until it functioned in its hand-drawn format and played like a good comedy in its hand-drawn format. And so once the animation started coming together, it was like so exciting, and it made it play so much better. And again, we were so hard on just like the material itself, the words without the animation, that it was just it was like the icing on the cake as far as how much it brought it all to life, and it looks so much better than I thought it was going to. That's like the overall thing I still think when I look at it. It's like, it looks really good.
I like it.
What did you, I mean, how long late in the process was it before you started really seeing significant footage, not just...
I mean, it comes in all these weird stages where you get everything in these animatics where everyone's cold and lifeless.
Animators talk about it being, you know, almost like the whole 5 years they'll spend, and then like in the last 8 weeks.
Well, I remember what was very encouraging is we're friends with Phil Miller, or Phil Lord and Chris Miller.
Hard to tell apart.
They won't watch this. But they told us that, like, with some of their animated movies, like, it really did not function until it was done, and it was, and that was very encouraging, because as we tried, but there were some things that you're just like until it all works, I hope it's not going to make any sense, really, you know, or as much sense as it should. And so and you could really tell what's happening, and so that was something that was nice just to hear early on in the process, was like, okay, like, other people whose work I really like had a similar feeling that I have, so that was nice. I think the scene with Barry and the druggie was the first scene that was, like, animated, right? That was the first scene we started to see, like, completed shots of.
Yeah.
And it was him, like, pulling the back off the drugs and pouring it in the
spoon. Yeah, they chose a weird place to start. It felt aggressive.
Yeah, it did. And I remember being like, whoa.
The first thing was the fire and the drugs.
Yeah, it was like the lighter being lit and it boiling in the spoon. Yeah. And I was like,
I would have been like, you should have just started with a sausage.
Yeah, I know. I was like, they're really... Well, because I think those shots hadn't changed. Like, that sequence just hadn't changed for years and years and years. So they started with what we knew we weren't going to change. But yeah, I remember seeing it and being like, it's lit really dark. Like, even that was weird because you're used to seeing these animated movies lit very kind of brightly. Yeah, it was really exciting. Like, yeah, that whole sequence with Barry and toilet paper and gum, that was all the first stuff to be completed. And it's some of like the weirder stuff in the movie, but it was so exciting.
Can you say gum's name? Do you?
Sorbitol, mannitol,
xylitol.
Xylitol.
Calcium, something and talc.
This could be a blue
xanthan gum.
Yeah, exactly.
Xanthan gum?
Yeah, I can't remember.
You can say it.
Sorbitol, mannitol, xylitol. I can't remember. That's the beginning of it.
So, what is your when the movie's done and you're showing it to people?
Yeah.
What is your relationship at that point with the movie? How much you paying
deep
attention to box office? How much you paying attention to the reaction?
Well, like immensely.
Immensely. More. I'm going more than ever.
Yeah. Way more than we did when we were younger. Like, I look back at how little I paid attention to that when we made Superbad and Knocked Up and Pineapple Express. Like,
well, also back then, I just needed to, like, I was like, Judd, did we do well? And if he said yes, I was like, yeah!
Yeah, I didn't get it. Like, honestly,
that's all I understood.
I didn't understand what a big opening weekend was. I didn't even know, like, how much money a success was considered. And so
I always thought things could, like, turn around in the third or fourth week.
Yeah, I just didn't get it at all. And so now, yeah, like, as we've gotten older, like, we're acutely aware of that stuff. And we don't take it for granted in any way, shape, or form when a movie either does well or is well received, you know, by audiences and by critics, and just kind of the general vibe of it is that it's a good movie and not a shitty movie. And so whenever that happens, we're very grateful.
Does it always match your impressions of yourselves?
No.
Oh, no.
Not
rarely.
At all.
Rarely.
It's hard to gauge. Some things are hard to gauge. We've made movies that we thought were going to get really good reviews that have gotten bad reviews. We've made movies that we thought were going to make a lot of money that have not made a lot of money. We have movies that we thought weren't going to make that much money that made more than we thought they were going to, you know? We have movies that we thought were going to get worse reviews than they did that got better reviews than they did. Like,
Green Hornet's probably the most schizophrenic movie ever in the history of Hollywood.
Well,
in terms of the perception of what was going on and the success of the movie.
No, it's true. Like, it did pretty well in the end.
Yeah.
And you actually look at how it was reviewed in the end, and it's not that bad on the grand scale.
Yeah. But
of,
the
like,
perception
how,
of it was a little weird at the time, but now I don't think it is.
Yeah, no, it is bizarre. And we've been on we've had every type of thing at this point in our careers. We've had movies that, you know, are great and do really well, and movies that are viewed as terrible and do terribly, and everything in between. And I think, because of that, over the years, you really start to, you appreciate it. And when you like a movie and you think it's good and people don't get it, it sucks. And when critics do get a movie and then audiences don't get it, it sucks. And when critics sort of like a movie and audiences really like it, it doesn't suck as much, but it's weird. But it's, this is like, it only happens a few times when a movie like makes as much money as you hoped it was going to and gets the types of reviews that you hoped it was going to. That, like,
and is what you wanted it to.
And when you watch the final product is what you hope to make. Like, it's just not something that, like, over the years, I did for sure take it for granted. I just didn't even get it. And now, as someone in like their mid-30s, like, I'm extremely grateful when that happens, you know.
And a dad.
He's a dad.
He shoots blanks.
Yes. It's our baby, technically.
Well, actually, I noticed Lauren has a funny credit in the IMDb.
It's
tampon, and then it says, as Lauren, and it's like a full name.
Yeah.
So it's like, tampon as. Like, what?
She plays a few people in the movie. She's also the people who eats the carrots. Yeah, we get a lot of, Evan plays like 6 voices in the movie.
Hidden in there.
Yeah.
So is that like an easy, are you guys competitive in terms of your writing or your work? Or
we're competitive about acting, which is brutal for me.
Who, us?
You and Lauren.
Oh, me and my wife?
Yeah.
No, not at all.
But tell us some of your problems.
Exactly.
Just tell us a few of your
marital. When you have the same job as your partner, inherently, there's, you know, it's both a lot. It's like working with your friends. It's a lot better in some ways, and it's harder in some ways, because there is a more direct comparison as to, you know, what's right. happening in each other's careers. But it's also, there's a lot of support built in, so that's nice also.
Do you guys feel like you've changed the industry, or you're part of the industry, into what you wanted it to be, as opposed to it changing, as opposed to you evolving into it? Or do you feel like you kind of become more classic Hollywood pros?
That question
guys.
Has befuddled me.
Yeah. What do you mean?
I mean, you guys always seem kind of laid back and happy and interested and doing a lot of things and a lot going on, which does not seem like how it always works.
No, I think we've worked very hard to
Phil and Chris kind of the same way.
Yeah.
Kind of like have created their little fiefdom.
Create a little bubble. I think we've worked hard to create a system that that's like, has longevity, you know, and that allows us to work on things that we think are interesting, and will continue to allow us to do that in a way that we have control over them. And there's like a myriad of ways that I think we've created that way to do it with ourselves over the years. I honestly think the biggest reason that we've been able to do it is that we don't make incredibly expensive movies, and because of that, we're able to make much riskier movies than a lot of people, I think. That is just exciting, and I think that's why we're engaged, because we haven't like settled into, you know, every movie we make is really hard to get made, you know, and we're constantly, to this day, to this moment, having hard times getting movies made because they're different, you know, Sausage Party being the best example. Like, no one wanted to make that movie at all. Like, it was like a hot potato, you know, like, it was tossed around, no one wanted it.
And your budget was tiny, I gather it was under $20 million, huh?
Yeah, and so it was...
For animation, that's...
Just under.
Yeah, it's crazy, and so This Is the End was the same thing, no one wanted to make it, like, and we were like, you know, like, successful filmmakers at that point, like, yeah, but it was so weird that people were just like, it's fucking weird, you know? And so that is something that we've just also, like, always just tried to do, is focus on trying to make things that, like, we're very passionate about and that are challenging, you know, in some way, or that we're able to justify, at least to ourselves, as being original in some way, you know?
Sausage Party for us was like, if we were working on something that we weren't enjoying, we could always go do this.
Exactly.
We're still doing what we want to do.
Yeah, it's true. And not every single thing we work on ticks every one of these boxes by any means, you know. We just like working a lot, and so at times you just tick as many of those boxes as you humanly can, and we do have a threshold. I mean, like, there's tons of things we don't make. If it seems like something we just would never go see, we don't make it. And we've made things that we thought would turn into things we would go see, and then you look at them in the end and you're like, I wish I wouldn't go see this. But we tried, but that's happening less and less, I think, as we get a little more control over our situation as well. But
well, comedians have traditionally kind of priced themselves out of their own market.
Yeah.
And it sounds like you guys are aware of this and have avoided this problem.
We're aware of that, and we're also aware that we need to learn how to do different genres. Like that's what Preacher was a big, you know, that's what was exciting about Preacher and it turning out well was, you know, as directors, it opened a whole other door for us, and directors ultimately get to cast their movies often. So as an actor, it opens up a whole other door for me. And as people who just see that, like, there's not a ton of directors who have, like, careers into their 60s and 70s making comedies, but there are guys like Scorsese and the Coen brothers who work, you know, into have incredibly long careers doing a wide range of genres. And that's something that we've talked about, is that, like, we're not going to be able to do this for, I don't even know if we can do it anymore. That might be it.
We need to find the young guys who know the next sausage party.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly.
I mean, it's true. I mean, I was good friends with Paul Mazursky, and it was like, he hit an age where he kind of aged out. And it wasn't people, it's the industry that's kind of ageist also. But there's also a different kind of humor that
it's true, and there are, but there are guys, there are people who are able to do it. Like, and, you know, and so there's hope. That's what we always look to. But it isn't, it often isn't in comedy. It's in more, you know, I think Scorsese movies are really funny, actually. And I think, like, you could argue that they are, you know, there are largely comedic chunks of them. And, like, you know, and I think, again, the Coen brothers are a good example. Like, you know, Tarantino's not, you know, I don't know how old he is now, but he still has, like, a very fresh, you know, perspective. And, again, because I think it's not strictly comedic. If right. those movies lived or died by how many laughs they got in any given minute, they probably wouldn't be as successful as they are in other genres.
So we can see your guys' version of Lear and Hamlet pretty soon? Or?
No.
maybe.
But I mean, you're interested in going in other directions.
Yeah.
Besides where you've been.
Yeah, well, we're also aware that, like, for movie theater-wise, like, it's harder to get people to go to movie theaters, you know? And movies we've made in the past, like, I bet Superbad we'd be pressured into putting it into, like, a digital release at this point in our lives, you know? Or at this, if That's it scary. Was something that we were making today, you yeah. know? We'd have a hard time arguing why it deserved to be in a movie theater, basically. And so we like to make, me and Evan have just talked, and we're like, we want to make movies in movie theaters. Like, we will also make movies probably that aren't in movie theaters, but it's something that we want to continue trying to do. We don't want to be people whose, like, genre is slowly edged out of theatrical release.
Right.
And so that's just something that we're aware of, you know, and is part of our conversations as we talk about what kinds of things we want to work on, you know.
And what is your relationship with being an actor these days compared with all this other stuff in your life?
I don't know. It kind of fits in where it can. Like, there are scripts that, like, we have that I've been attached to act in for a long time that we're still putting together, so.
You act a lot socially.
Exactly. I'm a sociopath.
But, I mean, are you anxious to go build the career further? I mean, you are a movie star. You do draw.
Yeah, I honestly don't, like, when I look at the things that I'm, like, really passionate about, acting is probably like third behind writing and directing, you know? And I really like acting. That's not to say I don't like it. And I actually like doing the Steve Jobs movie, part of me was actually considering, like, maybe I'm just gonna stop acting in other people's movies, basically, and even just stop, like, pursuing that as a thing. And then I had such a good time doing that, the exact opposite happens. And I call my agents, I'm like, I love that. I actually would love to have, like, that size role in movies just with people I would want to work with, because it was a educational experience for me. But
Daniel will spoil you.
Exactly. But
he's a pretty easy guy.
Yeah. It's. But I don't know. I mean, I will continue acting.
You're not putting your foot down.
Yeah.
You should retire and have comebacks.
I should always do that. I should Steven Soderbergh it. Oh, yeah. I'll retire from acting, and then I'll have my AD act for me.
Well, he doesn't even go on camera anymore. Last time we shot an interview with him, we shot his shoes.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Because he
wanted
to put his face on camera. He doesn't want to be seen. Because he runs around New York all the time, and he feels like people, when he's got a media thing going on, that people recognized him a lot on the street, and he didn't want that.
Oh, that's funny.
And
I get that,
shot
actually.
Girlfriend experience, I guess, on the streets without, you know, not with permits and whatever. And
I got you. He regretted making himself known.
He doesn't want to be a public face.
It's like Evan.
I'm a fucking shadow.
Yeah.
And this award
You're
stuff.
Not just shooting his shoes right now.
Not yet,
but that's all that's going to turn up on this. That's all you'll see when you play this back.
Just a vapor there.
Exactly.
I just saw a movie where they pretended to do that and it was truly horrible. Anyway, I'll tell you that off camera.
Great.
What was I going to say? So you're in awards mode now a little bit for this movie.
every year around this time we enter awards mode.
It's a tradition for me and Evan to enter awards mode. It's usually alone in my living room, but it's nice
care?
To be.
I mean, obviously, like, it's nice to be loved and all that, but
I just really don't want Sausage Party's journey to end.
Exactly.
That's what it is. I want to keep making Sausage Party in any way I can.
That is the real truth, is, like, we've been working on it for so long, I think we have some withdrawal of some sort.
It's like when you, like, come home from summer camp. Exactly. And you're just so sad.
And people ask us, like, do you want to talk about Sausage Party more? We're like, yeah, we'll talk about Sausage Party more.
Like, I can get a few more months out of this?
Yeah. I really like talking about it. No, I mean, we're just really proud of it. And honestly, like, our careers will be no different if we, you know, like, our careers don't rely on awards, thank God. Right. Would it be great for our egos? It'd be fantastic. I would feel, I would have such a better sense of self-worth. It would give me a real ego boost. But I don't know. Like, we've never done this before. They've never asked us to do this before for any movie we've ever made.
I actually pushed them on This Is the End, and they never really got
it.
I was like, that screenplay, I thought, was nominated.
I think 50-50 actually was, like, one of the best movies of the year. But I think, yeah, and so to us, it really boils down to, like, they're like, do you want to go talk about it? We're like, yeah, we'd love to. We love the movie. We're very proud of it. If people want to talk to us about it more, we're more than happy to. If, you know, and that's basically, it's mostly for our egos.
We'll keep talking about it until they tell us to stop.
Yeah, exactly.
But you guys feel part of the town at this point, after these years. You feel part of the Hollywood thing, I guess, on some level.
I mean, I guess.
When you go to the Academy Awards and turn up for...
I've never been invited to the Academy Awards.
You've presented, haven't you?
So I guess we've made it clear that
I've gone when I've presented.
Shouldn't you get to go when he presents?
Exactly, like, as my date.
He takes his wife.
Yeah.
You should be a +3 or +4 or whatever.
I haven't been in years.
You haven't asked if they'd give you another ticket.
No, it's true. I've kind of like, you know...
Would you want to go? Are you interested?
Yeah.
Okay.
Any of these things are fun. I've been to the Emmys. It was incredible. Into the Golden Globes.
If you're nominated, it's fun.
I was not nominated at MTV Movie Awards. That's always fun.
Yeah, that's true.
You really have fun at the MTV Movie Awards?
I have. You know, now would I?
You know,
I'm not sure.
Probably not.
I have.
Okay. When you were 28,
no, now
it's
not fun. Now you go and I still have to go, and I'm like, oh, I'm the oldest fucking person here by, like, 10 years. I don't even know who these people are. Like, I literally, like, some, like, there's new famous people. I don't even know who they are. Like, there's these young, handsome, famous boys. And, I literally have no fucking clue who they are. I know, really good for them, yeah.
Get up your game with more kids.
I need more young, famous boys in my life.
Well, after you've made Zac Efron a star again. I know.
That's where my knowledge, like, if you're younger than Zac Efron, I have no fucking clue who you are. Zac Efron, to me, is the youngest celebrity there is.
So when Chloe came on the set for Neighbors 2,
I had to learn her.
She
was Hit Girl. That's the only reason I did. Yeah.
Thank God for Hit Girl.
Exactly.
Thank you guys very much. Appreciate your time.
Thank you for having us.
Right on.
Lovely.
Cheers.
Oh, I have to pee so badly.
You made it, though, man. Good job.